intercession. It's probably one of the highest tasks that any human being can perform on this earth. To intercede is to plead in front of God on behalf of somebody else or on behalf of yourself. In the book of Numbers, that's where we are reading this week, in the book of Numbers, chapter 13, there is a dramatic incident. The Israelites, we got to the gate, to the limit, to the border of the land, of the promised land. We got to a place called Kadesh Barnea, and for certain reasons we did not dare to enter in the land and conquer the land. And we complain. And one of the things that we said is, why is God bringing us here? This is on chapter 14 of Numbers. If only we have died in Egypt or in the desert, why is the Lord bringing us to this land to die by the sword of these nations? And there is a conflict with God, and God said, I'm going to destroy this nation. And I'm going, Moses, to put you over a greater nation. And Moses intercedes in front of God on behalf of the Israelites. And Moses, this is the part that we are going to read, Moses says, Lord, you cannot destroy this nation. Lord, you cannot destroy this nation, not because of this nation, not because of me, but because of you. Because you promised, you said, Lord, that you will introduce this nation into a land that flows with milk and honey. Lord, if you don't do that, the Egyptians will say, God hasn't been able to accomplish this. Lord, it's not because of me, it's not because of the nation, it's because of your promises, it's because of your name, it's because of your faithfulness. Moses intercedes in front of God, and what Moses accomplished is amazing. Moses changed God's mind, and God says, Salachti kidvarecha, I had forgiven as you ask. Yes, Moses, I will introduce this nation into the land. Now, this is intercession. It's amazing. Intercession is to change God's mind on certain issue because of your wisdom, but because of his promises. You see, the basis that we have to wrestle with God is because he promised. And because he promised, he will accomplish. And God says, you are right, Moses. Salachti kidvarecha, I had forgiven as you ask. I will introduce not this generation, but the next generation will conquer this land. Now, let me read a few verses. If you do have your Bible with you, this is Numbers 14 from verse 13. Numbers 14, 13, and here is Moses' intercession. Vayomer Moshe el Adonai, veshimeu Mitzrayim ki elita vekoach et ha'am azeh mikrebo. And Moses said to the Lord, the Egyptians will hear that you ascended this nation in power to yourself. Veamru el yoshvei ha'aretz asot, Shamanu ki ata Adonai vekerev ha'am hazeh ayin ve'ayin nira ata Adonai ve'ananecha omet aleichem uve'amut anan ata olech lifneichem yom uve'amut esh laila. And they will tell the inhabitants of this land that they heard that you, O God, are with these people eye to eye. And you could, and your cloud stands over them. In the cloud, you lead them in front day by day with a pillar of cloud during the day and on fire by night. Verse 15. Ve'amata et ha'am azeh ki ish echad. Ve'amru agoim asher shamu et simcha le'emor. If you put to death these people like one man, then the nations who will hear this will say, verse 16, Mibilti icholet Adonai leabi et ha'am hazeh el aretz asher nishba lahem veishchatem vamidvar. The Lord has not been able to bring this nation to the land that he swore to them, So he killed them in the desert. Ve'ata igdal na akoach Adonai ka'asher divarta lahem. But you, O Lord, strengthen yourself in the way, in power, in the way that you have told them. Adonai, verse 18, Adonai erech pamaim, v'ra'av chaset noshe avon v'pashat, v'nake lo inake, poket avon, avot alvanim, al shloshim be'al revim. The Lord slow to anger, abounding in mercy, forgiving sin and transgression, but the guilty he will not leave unpunished, will punish the fathers over the sons, over the third and fourth generations. This is Moses' intercession. Lord, you promise, Lord, you said that you'll be that you will lead this nation into the promised land. Lord, you cannot destroy them. And God is going to say, yes, I promised. Yes, I will introduce them into the land. I don't know if you ever wrestle with God. It's very different to fight with God than to wrestle with God. Some people fight with God and they say, I don't want to hear about God, this God anymore. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about wrestling with God. You wrestle with God according to his promises. You wrestle with God because he promised. Think about this in the first place. Why is God giving us promises in the first place, if not for us to trust in them? In the Jewish nation, for 2,000 years, whenever a synagogue service ends, before the synagogue service ends, the rabbi will say, Ashana haba b'Yerushalayim, next year in Jerusalem. And we will always finish a service saying, next year in Jerusalem. This expression, next year in Jerusalem, is not just a word of hope. No, no, no. That was the promise of God. God promised to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and David, this land will be for you and for your descendants. And when we wander among the nations, in Europe, in all around the world, when we didn't have any land of our own, we kept saying, next year in Jerusalem. Why? Because God promised we will be back in Jerusalem. In 1948, that promise became true. But during 2,000 years, we kept telling each other, next year in Jerusalem. It was a way of saying,